We have a quorum, and it's the appointed time. Thank you for coming to this afternoon meeting of the Subcommittee on Members' Remuneration and Operating Expenses Reimbursement. Agenda item number one, outcome of consultation with members on proposals regarding review of operating expenses and reimbursement and remuneration. We have the outcome. Please refer to LC paper number HR 814/2023-01. This paper stipulates the outcome of the consultation. As we will make use of the request to speak button, so please do not change your seat after you're seated. In the meeting last time, this subcommittee agreed that all members should be consulted on the proposal of adopting weighted index instead of consumer price index C as the basis for annual adjustment to members' office operation expenses reimbursement, OOER. In July, the Secretariat issued questionnaires to all members with 79 replies. The consultation outcome is set out in the paper mentioned just now. The paper has been circulated to members. Will the clerk please brief us on this paper? Thank you. In the 79 members who responded to the questionnaire, most of them support the proposal of the subcommittee on adopting a weighted index as the basis for annual adjustment. That is to replace consumer price index C. 75 members agreed that it should be adopted. That is, the weighted index should be adopted. In terms of weightings for the weighted index, members think that three components should be included, including staff expenses, office accommodation expenses, and other operating expenses, respectively. 70% should be adopted for staff expenses, 10% for office accommodation expenses and staff, and 20% for operating expenses. There are 50 members who support the subcommittee's proposal. That is, we should use the civil service pay adjustment for middle and lower salary bands as the adjustment factor for staff expenses. There are 70 members who support using the nominal index for payroll per person engaged from the labor earnings survey. That was the proposal of the Independent Commission in 2020. For our office accommodation expenses component, there are 65 members who agree that we should make use of rental index for grade C offices compiled by the Ratings and Valuation Department, RVD. Lastly, for other operating expenses, there are 73 members who agree that composite consumer price index, composite CPI, should be used for the adjustment factor instead of CPIC. Last item on whether there should be a one-third reduction in the monthly remuneration for LegCo members and if it should be abolished. There are 62 members who think that the arrangement should be abolished. As for office accommodation expense, there are 19 members who think that we should include another index, that is the rental index for private retail properties, as the basis for adjustment. So what is this rental index? In paragraph 6 of the paper, we set out in the paper or in the table that, well, in the first column, it is the rental index for grade C offices that is supported by the subcommittee. The second column includes the proposal as suggested by the 17 members, that is the rental index for private retail properties. Most of the two of the indexes are proposed by the RVD. For the percentage change, the rate of increase for rental index for grade C offices is higher than that for private retail properties. The 19 members did not propose any weightings for the two indexes if they are both included in the adjustment factors. So this is the outcome of the consultation. So would members please consider? Thank you. on rental index for grade C offices and rental index for private retail properties, as shown on the table, the difference is quite significant. For retail industry, as you can imagine, the fluctuation is rather substantial because it reflects the actual market situation. Will a lot of members be renting private properties as their offices? Do we have such figures, Secretariat? We don't have such data. As far as I understand, I don't think a lot of members are renting private retail properties as their office. So if you would like to speak on the outcome, please press the button. Thank you, Mr. Stephen Ho. Thank you. Let me set the time, 4 minutes per member. On the last item about the rent, as the term of LegCo members is approximately 4 years, when we sign tenancy agreement, it usually is renewed one time only. So we think that we should try to seek a stable income. As mentioned in paragraph 6, the indexes is sometimes negative 7.6, negative 2.6, sometimes it's positive 3. I think that the fluctuation is rather substantial because rent accounts for about 10% of our total expenses. I think that we should keep the rental index for grade C offices as the adjustment factor. For staff expenses, it accounts for about 70% of our total expenses. There is great fluctuation in staff expenses component adjustment factor. Thank you. These adjustment factors are to set a standard for reference. So we are not adjusting the expenses or ceiling every month or every year even. We had much discussion last time in the meeting. We want to align the ceiling to the market situation. That is why we adopt these adjustment factors upon conducting this survey among members. Actually, most members support the proposals of the subcommittee. Any other member would like to put questions? We had a detailed discussion in the last meeting. The proposal has the support of most members. So should we endorse paragraphs 3, bracket A to C, and paragraphs 3E to F? As for paragraphs 3D and G, that is the adjustment factors for office accommodation expenses, as you've heard, there are members who think that we should take into account the rental index for private retail properties. If we are to adopt this index, we have to ask all members about how we should take forward that and the weightings for the two indices. This is not the view of the majority of the members. Why don't we just adopt the rental index for grade C offices so that we don't have to issue another round of questionnaires? Do we all agree to this? Yes? No objection? If we decide that the rental index for private retail properties, that is index B, if it is not to be included, then the proposal of adopting weighted index as the basis for annual adjustment to OER, along with the three adjustment factors, will be submitted for House Committee's consideration. If the proposal is endorsed by the House Committee, then it will be referred to the administration. The administration will consider the views of the Independent Commission on Remuneration for members of the Executive Council and the Legislature and officials under the political appointment system of the Hong Kong SAR before deciding. So the administration will have to refer to the views of this independent commission. If endorsed, the proposal will take effect in the next legislative term. So this term's members will not be affected. So that concludes this agenda item. Next, proposals on enhancing the procedure for reimbursement for members' operation expenses. Please refer to LC paper number HRA 14/2023-02. The title is the same as what I've mentioned. The Secretariat has reviewed the current reimbursement procedures for of members' operating expenses, and they made three proposals, which are set out in the paper that I just mentioned. Would the Secretary please walk us through the proposals? Ms. Zhong, please. Thank you, Chairman. The Secretariat would like to make three proposals in accordance with our experience and processing members' operating expenses to enhance the efficiency of the reimbursement processes. There are three proposals. Proposal one is consolidating setting up and information technology expenses reimbursement and office operation expenses reimbursement. They are SUTER and OOER in short. As you all understand that these expenses are to be reimbursed once per LegCo, the reimbursement is $175,000. These expenses can be reimbursed as soon as members take office. They can use the expenses to renovate their office, purchase computers, and do maintenance work. The second type is the office operation expenses. I'm sure you're all familiar with it. That's the expenses that will be adjusted in accordance with the weighted index. The ceiling is about $2.9 million. They can make use of the expenses to buy furniture and procure services and make payment for telecommunication services along with hiring staff. There are a lot of overlapping areas in these two expenses for purchasing capital items and for paying telecommunication services. They can claim them under OER and SUTER. Currently, we have to maintain two sets of expense item classifications and reimbursement procedure. We think that there is a duplication of effort involved, so we propose to consolidate these two expense items. So SUTER will be subsumed under OOER for operation purposes. The amount will not be changed because that is not to be determined by us, but the administration. The administration will take into account the views of the subcommittee and the independent commission as mentioned by the chairman. And next two sets out the scenario upon consolidation. In the operating expenses, as you can see, the ceiling is $2 million odd that was subsumed under OOER. In 2022, the members' ceiling for OOER is $2.8 million. And the SUTER accounts for amounts to about $375,000. If the expenses is not reimbursed in full, then they can make use of the remainder in the next year. So the unused expenses can be rolled over to the next year or carried forward to the next year. As you can see, there are some ticks in the second and third rows. so that members' office or staff won't have to think about what kind of expenses the payment is for reimbursement. Let me move on to the next proposal. That is revising the threshold for capitalizing items. So what is capital item in accordance with our guide? If the piece of equipment or furniture costs more than $3,000 with a lifespan of over 1 year, then that is a capital item, including, for example, mobile phones or computers. Currently, members will have to keep an inventory list and submit it to the Secretariat in December each year. When they cease office, you have to return it to the Secretariat or buy them at a depreciated value. In Note 1, as you can see, that is the calculation for the depreciation. There is some requirements for that. So you have to retain the capital item.
Now, one may think that under the threshold, if it is still 3,000. It has been implemented since October 2016, so it has been 7 years. So as you may think, there may be a revision of the threshold. It is proposed that it should be revised from 3,000 to 3,500 or 5,000. We will have to see which the amount is. In fact, for 5,000 in 2016, the Secretariat consulted the auditor who was appointed to conduct audits. We asked the auditor what the amount for capitalizing items for NGOs of size similar to that of members' offices is. The auditor advised that it would be 5,000 or over. In 2016, the then subcommittee issued a questionnaire to ask about the threshold. Most of the members agreed that the threshold of 3,000 should be adopted. So members may consider whether it should be revised to 3,500 or 5,000. Or members can choose to consult all members on the proposal. Proposal 3, reimbursing a portion of other operating expenses on a non-accountable basis. Well, non-accountable expenses is not new to members. For example, transportation expenses are non-accountable. For operating expenses, both OOER and SUITER are both accountable at the moment. So why we are proposing this is that for stationery and other expenses of the kind, they take up a very small proportion of the expenses. They take up only 12% of the total value of transactions, but it takes up over half, 51% of the total number of transactions. If some of these are made non-accountable, it will save time and it can enhance efficiency. You can perhaps refer to Appendix 3. There are four expenses set out here. For other operating expenses, it would exclude staff expenses, capital items, as well as office operating expenses. The number of transactions, as you can see here, is over half, but the amount of the transaction takes up only 12%. So we are proposing to make these transactions non-accountable. We can then look at Appendix 4. It is said there, for consultancy services. we would suggest that consultancy services be excluded from non-accountable items. It is because we have imposed requirements for the use of consultancy services to avoid conflict of interest. The requirements are providing the names of consultants and the costs of the consultancy and making them available for public inspection, refraining from engaging the member's political party or any organization which his or her political party has control of as a consultant, disclosing the precise nature and scope of the consultancy work on the invoices to be submitted. For other items, for example, photocopying charges, meter charges, stationery, or printing, they only take up 8.44% of the total value of transactions, but again, it accounts for 50% of the total number of transactions. That's why we propose to make these non-accountable to enhance efficiency. But we'll impose some requirements. For example, the value, the maximum value for each item is to be set at 3,499 or 4,999. That is subject to the approval of the proposal for revising the threshold for capitalizing items. And then we are proposing the ceiling for the non-accountable component be set at 5% of the annual maximum reimbursable amount for OOER. That is taking the 2.9 or 3 million figures, it would be about $500,000. But members will wonder if 5% is enough. In fact, you can look at Appendix 5. If we set the figure at 3,500 or 5,000, 90% of the members will only be using 5% of the figure. We believe that's why 5% should be adequate. If members endorse the proposals, although these items will be made non-accountable, members will have to keep the receipts for the other operating expense items for auditing purposes. And these proposals take effect only from the 8th LegCo. And members are invited to consider whether they wish to consult all members before submitting the proposals to the House Committee for consideration. Members, in relation to the proposals mentioned by the Secretary, you can express your views. I personally think that the three proposals are reasonable because it saves time and costs. For example, the proposal one, consolidating SUITER and OOER. If the expenses are to be dealt with in two categories, that is unnecessary. To have SUITER subsumed under OOER, it works the same. As in your offices, the accountants would have to follow these processes as well. If we simplify the procedures, first of all, I have to stress that it will not bring about any change to the overall reimbursement amounts. It just streamlines procedures. As for the revision of the threshold for capitalizing items, I think we should just go up to $5,000, and I think this is reasonable. If it is $3,000 for capital items, you have to keep an inventory list and you have to take stock every year. As members may know, in your offices, you will need to have someone come in to your offices to count the items, and then the when the auditor comes, you have to show the auditor these items. If we raise the threshold to 5,000, the items worth between 3,000 and 5,000 will not have to be kept in the inventory list. A third proposal, I keep receipts for all the items myself. I also keep the receipts for transportation expenses. In our routine work, as said by the Secretariat, as it only takes up 12% of the total value of transactions, it takes up 51% of the total number of transactions. I believe with monitoring, we should only deal with the significant items. If they dedicate so much effort in dealing with miscellaneous or insignificant transactions, that will be unnecessary. Members may express your views. But I would like to remind members that even if we agree on the proposals today, we will have to consult all members on the proposals. So members, if you wish to express your views, please press the request to speak button. Well, if members are not speaking, well, Mr. Dennis Leung, please. Thank you, Chair. Well, in relation to the first proposal, the members will no longer have to submit two forms to reclaim expenses. So it will facilitate members in the sense that if we have made a mistake, we do not have to write up another form. I want to clarify if that is the case, because we want to make sure we are making claims correctly. Can they clarify how it works? Because the public may not understand how the process works. Well, Secretary, please. They will no longer be two classifications. But as said, the amounts are determined by the administration. That's why the amounts will not change. So the amounts will not be changed. It's just that they won't have to be, the expenses won't have to be dealt with in different categories. For example, we do not have to single out some special IT expenses. This saves time. So is it the case that the SUITER can be claimed under OOER? Yes. Well, that is the point. We do not have to separate the two categories. Well, for the SUITER, the threshold is perhaps a certain amount, $1.2 million. You do not need to specify which category it is with this proposal implemented. Well, for new members, they may have a higher amount that they can use on SUITER. I think that was the case before when it was said. Well, I understand your question. I'll let the Secretary answer that. Well, basically, the uses will not change, but I'm not sure if members' assistants know that some part of the amount will be carried forward. In fact, people are using it interchangeably at the moment. So with the existing arrangements, some assistants think the arrangements are very troublesome. So why not have SUITER subsumed under OOER? It would just be streamlined. So for example, for IT expenses, should one need to spend more, what is going to happen? Well, for example, you will purchase IT equipment in the first year and you have used up the SUITER, it doesn't mean that you can't buy computers from then on. You then can use the OOER to purchase computers. But then that is still subject to a ceiling, and they are subject to audit. It's just that we are combining the two classifications to make things easier. Basically, it is subject to a ceiling, but we no longer worry as much about the category. In essence, it offers more flexibility and it facilitates the processing by the Secretariat.
So there will not be the case that members will be using more money. So it's not the case that you can spend expenses that was not available to you before. So the amount is just the same. Next, Mr. Stephen Ho. I think it would be clear for members if you refer to Appendix 2. I am a rather experienced member. In the past, there was a ceiling that fell off in our office, but we had used up the SUITER expenses. So I covered it by claiming the expenses under OOER. I'll call it the small wallet. They will be used up for sure. The purchasing of computer would take up a large portion of the SUITER. If we can consolidate the two, then it will facilitate the Secretariat in processing the reimbursement. I don't think that will affect members that much. For the $3,500 and $5,000 expenses on a non-accountable basis, I would like to ask about that. If the threshold of 5% is exceeded, it will need receipts. So how many percent of members reimburse payment with value more than 5% of the value of all transactions? Or the 5% of the annual maximum reimbursement amount for OOER? You can refer to Appendix 2. So all expenses under OOER would need receipts. So how many percent of members will claim transactions for value more than 5% of all of maximum reimbursement amount? There are two members who claim expenses that amount to 6% of the maximum reimbursement amount. Appendix 6. So there are very few members who will utilize the maximum reimbursable expenses. The paper says that for value for transactions that are worth more than $4,999, then receipt would be needed. I support this. That's my personal view. Thank you. Any other comments? So for the threshold for capitalizing items, should we revise it to $3,500 or $5,000? Any comment? We need to consult all members, but we would like to hear from you now. Mr. Dennis Lang, we will not be making a decision today. We're not to make a decision now, but we have to come up with a proposal for the for all members' reference. Can we just let all members choose by issuing questionnaires? No comment? Okay. So we can put both choices in the questionnaires for all members to choose. So we will need to issue questionnaires to all members. Let me take a look at the timetable. As with prevailing practice, through the Secretariat, the Subcommittee will issue questionnaires to all members at the beginning of the third legislative session, that is early next year, to collect their views on the issues that we've just mentioned. And the level of members' remuneration and operating expenses, along with information on operating expenses, to facilitate our proposal. So we all agree with this. Any other comments? Secretary General, any comment? No? There being no other business, I think we've covered all items today. The meeting is adjourned. The Secretariat will inform members on the date of the next meeting. Thank you.